a good girl, loves her mom, loves Jesus, in America too. She's a good girl, is crazy about Elvis, loves horses, and her boyfriend too. It's a long day living in Reseda. There's a freeway running through the yard, and I'm a bad boy, 'cause I don't even miss her. I'm a bad boy for breaking her heart.
In this video, we'll be reviewing a hand between two of the end bosses of Cash No Limit Hold'em, Limitless and Linus Love. These two have been holding tables for some of the craziest cash games played in the history of online poker, where pots the size of home mortgages have been shipped back and forth on a regular basis. Limitless, it appears, has acquitted himself quite well in these games. Fueled by a potent combination of pierogies, Pornhub, and crystal meth, Limitless has bolstered his reputation as one of the most fearless players on the planet, constantly seeking to battle the best at astronomical stakes. In fact, Limitless has even gone so far as to offer other well-known crushers incentives to play him, such as by spotting them big blinds or playing them while drunk.
And like, I can offer also playing drunk. Like, I can drink on the stream, like I drink like a whole bottle of wine, and I can play Fedor heads up any stakes you want.
And when he didn't get any bites with these offers, he tried to troll them into playing by offering Railbirds cash prizes to guess how long these crushers could hang with him in a cash game.
Hey Jacob, are you okay?
And as for Linus, well, he's widely regarded by many as the best cash game player in the world. Linus started out with humble beginnings, but quickly skyrocketed to the nosebleeds. How did he achieve this meteoric rise? Well, according to Stefan Sondheimer, who was once Linus's neighbor, Linus's rapid success was due to a religious devotion to mastering GTO. I never saw him outside his flat for years. I remember one party that his roommate had. I arrived at 9 p.m. and left at 5 a.m. and I didn't see him at all. I asked his roommate where he was and he told me, oh, he's here. He's just solving some solvers in his office. So he was just there all the time and never showed up. I really haven't seen him outside too much. He just keeps running the solvers, studying all the spots, preparing for everything that might come up. However, despite his high standing among poker's elite, Linus has had his fair share of huge losses in these games, which have led some to question whether he remains as top dog. Has his apparent downswing been merely attributable to variance, or has he lost his edge? Although you can't really glean much from such a small sample size, we'll be reviewing this hand against Limitless to see if it points to any strategic leaks in his game from a GTO perspective. So we are six-handed, playing 500,000 with a $200 ante, and Limitless opens the action on the button 2.5x with King 9 of Hearts. The action folds around to Linus in the big blind, and he raises it 5x with Queen 10 of Clubs, and Limitless calls. All of this is relatively standard according to this custom preflop sim we've run using Simple Preflop. As we can see, with the ante in play, the ranges are significantly wider compared to a no-ante 6-max game, and interestingly, the solver is doing very little 4-betting on the button, and instead, it is mostly calling with its continuing range, including by slow-playing aces. The flop comes 7 King King Rainbow with no clubs, and Linus continues with around a 30% pot bet. This is a board that pretty heavily favors Linus as he holds all the nuttish hands and he also has a tighter range. And so we see that the solver is betting nearly 100% of its range, and the EV regret for betting this sizing is around 1%. So choosing to simply range bet here in Linus's shoes should be generally okay. Limitless calls, which we see is pretty standard. With a 3-bet pot, the SPR is already getting quite short, so it shouldn't be too difficult to get stacks in by the river when in position. Additionally, the board is also quite dry, and it generally favors Linus. Accordingly, Limitless's strongest hands don't have much incentive to raise, either for protection or to build a pot, which in turn should also dampen his overall bluff frequency as well. The turn is the 5 of hearts, and Linus fires again, this time with around a half pot bet. This card is not the best for Linus's specific range, since although he does likely have pocket 5s and king 5 in his range, it's unlikely that preflop he 3-bet these combos with 100% frequency from the big blind, and it's much more likely that Limitless called the 3-bet with these combos on the button. Right, we can clearly see with both ranges juxtaposed that Limitless has a higher proportion of these combos in his range, as evidenced by their darker shade. As such, Linus's range advantage is diminished on the turn. Although he still does have the advantage in average equity, Limitless now has the advantage at the top of the range as well as in average EV, which is likely due, at least in part, to being in position. So given all this, we see that the range is doing a lot of checking, and the lowest EV regret is around 2%, so we're going to drill down to the meso-analysis to examine Linus's strategy from a class perspective. Here on the turn, Queen 10 of clubs is pretty clearly a non-realizing hand, so Linus should be incentivized to bluff, as his likelihood to win at showdown is quite limited. But Linus can't allocate all of his weak hands to bluffs, given that, as we just discussed, his range overall is doing a significant amount of checking. Right, even though we're in a 3-bet pot, there was a hefty ante in play and it's button versus big blind, which means the ranges are just about as wide as they can be for a 3-bet pot. So Linus can't mindlessly barrel with all of his trash, or he will be easily exploitable by a discerning opponent, which Limitless certainly qualifies as. So how should Linus construct his bluffing range? Well, as I've described in prior videos, in the GTO check system, when the range is mixing its play and we are holding a hand in the non-realizing class, our allocation of bluffs will generally be determined by microanalysis factors, namely incremental equity, blockers, and unblockers. As a refresher, incremental equity refers to the characteristics of a hand that incrementally increase its likelihood to win a showdown compared to other similarly situated combos in the same class, namely front door and back door draws, overcards, and rank slash kicker. However, while knowing that these factors drive strategies is not a huge secret, knowing how these factors drive strategies is a much more difficult puzzle to crack, since there are no universal rules that can guide us on how the solver mixes and weighs these microattributes in every spot. That being said, generally speaking, incremental equity tends to be more important on earlier streets versus later streets, since draw equity diminishes when there are less cards to come, and of course, draw equity no longer applies on the river. And in contrast, blockers and unblockers tend to gain more importance on later streets as the player's ranges shed combos and become more narrow, thereby increasing the effects of card removal. So in this case, we're on the turn, and we see that incremental equity in the form of front door draws is significantly influencing the allocation of bluffs when compared to combos in the same class of unmade hands without a draw. This is a phenomenon that most players are already very familiar with, since front door draws have a significant chance to leapfrog over the stronger hands in the opponent's range on various runouts, and therefore they don't lose much equity when villain calls. However, we see that not all front door draws are being bluffed, and in many situations, particularly when the ranges are wider, the GTO strategy for draws will be mixed. So why is this? Well, as I've noted in prior videos, at the Nash equilibrium, GTO strategies always follow the actions that produce the greatest EV, with the one exception being mixed strategy spots where the EVs are identical for multiple actions. This occurs when there is no single action that will maximize EV against all possible strategies of the opponent, due to the fact that when hero uses a pure strategy with a particular action, villain will be able to adjust, which in turn will maximize hero's EV for an alternative action. And if hero instead uses a pure strategy with the alternative action, villain can readjust, which again will maximize hero's EV for a different action. So in the context of front door draws, in many situations from a GTO perspective, hero can't semi-bluff with 100% of these hands because 1, hero would likely be over-bluffing, and 2, when the draw does come in, hero's range would be nut-heavy, allowing villain to easily get away from paying hero off. However, on the other hand, playing 100% of hero's draws passively would likely A, result in hero underbluffing, or B, force hero to allocate too many bluffs to hands with very poor equity or hands that would rather pot control. So in GTO, front door draws are often played with mixed frequencies that have identical EVs. However, when we mix our play with front door draws, it will usually mean that in order to maintain balance and an optimal bluffing frequency, we'll need to allocate bluffs to other combos, which may not be so intuitive, and this allocation will often be dictated by blockers and unblockers. When bluffing, we generally want to block the stronger combos in our opponent's range and unblock the weaker combos in our opponent's range. So if we isolate Linus's weakest unmade hand without a draw and brush through the blocker scores, we see that the combos with the highest blocker scores, which are mostly firing a second barrel, contain some combination of Queen X, Jack X, and 10X, and these combos have an EV regret of less than 1% for a half pot bet. Whereas the combos with the lower blocker scores, which we see are mostly these combos with a lower card and or a spade or diamond, are mostly checking. This makes sense when we consider the fact that the strongest combo in Limitless's range outside of the full house is trip kings, and the only King X hands in his range that have both suited and unsuited combos are King Queen, King Jack, and King 10. So holding a queen, jack, or 10 is a positive micro-attribute, and holding a diamond or a spade is a negative micro-attribute, as holding a diamond or spade would mean that Linus does not block the suited King X combos in Limitless's range, given that the King of Diamonds and King of Spades are already on the board. Similar to the flop we see in Limitless's shoes, that simply calling is the play here, as he's in position, the board is still relatively dry with only one card to come, Linus has a significant advantage at the top of the range, and the SPR is now less than 1. The river is the Jack of Spades and Linus shoves. It appears that the Jack generally favors Linus's range, as he has a number of combos of pocket Jacks that have arrived at the river with his line, whereas Limitless has very few pocket Jacks. As such, we see the solver is betting with high frequency in the big blind shoes. However, most of the bets are allocated to betting third pot instead of shoving. This is likely due, at least in part, to the fact that Limitless's calling range is mostly uncapped. As we previously mentioned, due to the shorter SPR, the dry board, and being in position, the solver was doing virtually no raising in the button's shoes facing Linus's bets on the flop and turn, meaning that Limitless arrives at the river by generally only shedding the weakest combos that should have folded to two barrels, but the top of the range remains largely intact. So his overall range is quite strong despite only passively calling, and this is reflected in his overall advantage in both EV and equity. With this information in mind, how should Linus construct his triple barrel range on the river with his unmade hands? Well, obviously draws are no longer a factor, so now we're going to focus exclusively on blockers and unblockers to guide our decision. And again, we want to identify our best bluffing candidates by analyzing the combos in Linus's range that are blocking Limitless's strongest hands and unblocking his weakest hands. So to help guide our analysis, again, we're going to use the blocker and unblocker scatter chart. First, we're going to brush the hands with the highest blocker and unblocker scores in this class, and we see pretty clearly that the solver overwhelmingly favors bluffing these hands, betting nearly 100% of the time, with an EV regret of less than 1 for shoving. This class includes higher Queen X combos that block many of the trips in Limitless's range, and with the increased overall betting frequency compared to the turn, and Linus's range becoming more polarized, we see that Ace X is also now being bluffed with high frequency, likely since it blocks the slow played aces in Limitless's range. And if we move our filter to combos with a high blocker score but a low unblocker score, we see that the solver is doing much more checking. And not surprisingly, most of these are combos that do block a number of trips, but contain a heart, since the heart blocks the numerous missed flush draws in Limitless's range that would likely fold to a bet. And if we move our filter to combos with a low blocker score but high unblocker score, we see a bit of a mixed strategy with some betting and some checking. These are lower ranked combos that don't block as many trips in Limitless's range, but they do unblock some of the weaker hands he's likely holding, particularly flush draws. And finally, when we filter to the combos with a low blocker and unblocker score, we see that the solver is mostly giving up, as these hands don't block many of Limitless's trips, but at the same time they do block a number of his missed flush draws and or straight draws, such as 8-6, 9-6, and 9-8 with one or two hearts. So out of all of Linus's unmade hands, Queen 10 of Clubs is actually one of the best, if not the best, bluffing candidate he has. It blocks a number of King X combos in Limitless's range, both suited and unsuited, and it also unblocks his missed flush and straight draws. Accordingly, we see that it has one of the highest blocker and unblocker scores in this class. In Limitless's shoes, this is a pretty easy call. No need to drill down to the microanalysis. Trips are strong enough to call with all of the combos in this class, as they even beat some of Linus's value bets, such as his aces. In fact, we see that given the relatively small all-in bet in relation to the pot, the solver is using a pure calling strategy all the way down to second pair, and then it sprinkles in some additional bluff catching with weaker hands as well, based on their blocking and unblocking properties. So overall, despite losing a 200k pot by barreling a hand with very low equity, according to the solver, this was not a punt by Linus. And in fact, his line actually loses 0 EV compared to the GTO solution. And this highlights one of the benefits of checking your play against GTO, in that even when you're in the midst of a major downswing or upswing, you can always ground yourself in reality by comparing your play to the objectively determined Nash equilibrium solution, which may help maintain some sanity in the face of volatile variance. So that is the video for today. Thanks for watching, and until next time, stay bounce. Give me my money in stacks and lace my bitches with dime fingers. Real niggas fingers on nickel plated non-triggers. Must see my enemies defeated. I catch them while they coked up and weeded open fire.